morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to church this morning. I don't know the week that you've had, but good or bad, God's power is more.
Amen.
And we are not supposed to have all the power because we just don't. If I did, things would be a lot different. But but God has the power to work anything, good or bad, for his glory. And his power is present in our lives. So let's stand and sing.
There's a name that levels mountains, carves out highways through the sea. I've seen its power unravel battles right in front of me. There's a faith that stands defiant. Sends Goliath to his knees. I've seen his praise unravel shackles right off my feet. 'Cause that's the power of your name. Just a mention makes a way. Giants fall and strongholds break, and there is he. There's a hope that calls out courage in the furnace unafraid. The kind of daring expectation that every prayer I make is on an empty grave. 'Cause that's the power of your name. Just a mention makes a way.
Amen. Is that what you are claiming this morning? as you are going through life. You may be seated. That same power that rolled that stone away, that same power that rose Christ from the dead is available to you and I. It's the power that we have to live through life in the midst of all of the craziness and the discouragement and the frustrations and the difficulties and all of that. That is the power that we can claim. That is the power that we can live in and through this morning. So welcome to church.
Hi.
Oh, my word. Might as well go home. For you online, welcome to church. I hope your response is better than what I had in here. Good morning. It's great to have you here this morning, and I trust that you've come expecting that power in your life, expecting to hear from God this morning. Just a couple of announcements that I want to bring your attention to. First of all, God's Diner has its grand opening this evening. VBS starts tonight. All are welcome to come this evening at 6 o'clock for a meal, and then stick around for a little bit of time of worship and kicking off Vacation Bible School. Whether you have children that age or whether you don't have children that age, whether you're coming to VBS or not, come this evening for a good time of worship, of a little picnic supper, and just kicking off Vacation Bible School. If you are a part of Vacation Bible School, if you can come at 4:30 tonight, or if you'd like to just help up to finish setting up, that would be wonderful. And then be praying for Vacation Bible School tonight, 6 to 8 through Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, through Wednesday. Four nights of Vacation Bible School. Be praying for those that are coming and for those that are serving and participating and working in Vacation Bible School. Right after church is Chick Chat for you ladies to stick around for that. There's some other things that are taking place this week and in the near future in the life of our church. The Children's Sunday School changes a little bit next week, so be aware of that. Some Bible studies that are going on, a five-day club that's coming up a little bit later. So hang on to that. Be praying about those different events and asking how you can participate and be a part of those different events. In Joshua chapter 24, I pulled my page out before I got there. In Joshua chapter 24, we find these familiar words. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. This Joshua says these words at the end of his life, just before he dies, right? So the Israelites have been in the promised land for a while. They've conquered a majority of the promised land. And yet Joshua is encouraging the people. Hey, listen, you've got a choice, right? And every day you and I have a choice. What gods are we going to serve? And Joshua even says in here, they've been out of Egypt for a long time. But yet some of them are still hanging on to some of those old gods. And they were worshiping them at times as well. And so just that warning for us, just that caution for us this morning. What are we here to worship? What are we here to worship? We're here to worship Yahweh, the one true God. Letting go of all those other things, the gods that the world throws at us and wants us to worship and wants us to serve. And maybe even some of those things that we hang on to. And so, Father, this morning, as we just humble ourselves before you, Lord, I pray that prayer that we're going to talk a little bit about, Lord, that you would search us, that you would know us. You'd know every anxious thought that we have in our hearts. Lord, even at the beginning of the service here, we just give you permission to root out that hardness of our heart, the God of popularity, the God of money, the God of pleasing people, whatever it might be that sometimes creeps into our life and we begin to serve that God rather than you. We praise you. We worship you this morning. We thank you, Father, for your power. We thank you, Lord, for that power that enables us to get through life, to face the battles that we face. May our worship be pleasing in your sight this morning. Just descend upon us, I pray, Father. Thank you for what you're going to do. In your name I pray, amen. Let's stand back up and just continue worshiping God this morning.
When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds. Nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see my beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. Before us, nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win. And
about the name of Christ that we claim when we are fighting through our battles, and how strongholds can literally fall off at the name of Jesus. There is no other name in this universe that holds that kind of power. Let's praise that beautiful name.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. Beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. Want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. Name it is, nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The children are dismissed. They may be a mess too, but dismissed to head downstairs to junior church. And just before we jump into this parable that we want to look at this morning, want to take just a few moments to pray for and pray over. So if you are involved in Vacation Bible School, tonight, through the week, come on up front just real quickly so that we can have a prayer over you and put some faces to Vacation Bible School and be praying for the workers. It's a long week. It's in the evening. Many of them will be working during the daytime, and then coming, helping out in the evening. And so just come on up and let's put a face to Vacation Bible School. Look at them. Don't look at me. Appreciate all those that are helping out in Vacation Bible School this week. Do we still need some help? Are we? We're okay? But if you have a spare 2 hours from 6 to 8 and want to come and be a part of it, come on down. We'll find something for you to do. Even if it's just eat. There you go. Even if it's just eating, you can come and help out or have time of prayer, be praying for it on site or whatever. But thank you, each of these volunteers. And so be praying for them this week. Let's just pray. Father, we do thank you for this ministry. And Lord, you know exactly who's coming. You know exactly the home that they're coming from. You know exactly whether they're churched or unchurched or whatever. And Lord, we just pray just for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit this week on our Vacation Bible School. There's lots of things that our children, lots of things for the children to do this summer. But Lord, I thank you for those that have registered and those that will be coming this week. Lord, I pray especially for these that are standing here and others that are volunteering this week and serving. Lord, we know that when people step out to be obedient to you, that Satan attacks. We know that Satan wants to disrupt what is going to take place this week, and children hearing Bible stories and driving stakes deeper and hearing the gospel story and children coming to know you as Lord and Savior for the first time. And we know that Satan doesn't want that to happen. And so he's going to work hard to disrupt that and to discourage and to throw all kinds of roadblocks. But we just sang about it. We know from your word that you are greater, that you are more powerful, and that the battle belongs to you. And so, Lord, we just pray for this week and for those couple of hours each night, Lord, just for your blood to be poured over this place and to cover this place. Lord, we again just pray for soft hearts and for children to be receptive to the Bible stories and especially the gospel message that will be shared on Wednesday night. And Lord, for interactions, not with just the children, but with the parents as well. Lord, that there would be good relationships built, there would be good bridges built to homes. And so we just thank you in advance for what you're going to do. We look forward to how you're going to win this battle this week, and we look forward to answers to prayer and testimonies of what has happened in the life of these volunteers, in the life of our church, but more importantly, in the lives of the children. Even this week, even this morning, Lord, we heard the testimony of a child receiving a tract in a department store and then coming to mom and dad and say, I want to accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Lord, we pray that that would happen multiple times this week because of the volunteer, because of the energy and the effort and the time and the sacrifice of these people that are standing here in this church. In your name I pray, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. And be praying for Vacation Bible School and those that are serving this week. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21, the first book in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the first book in the New Testament. Matthew chapter 21. We are working our way through some of the different parables. Last week we started our summer sermon series, and we're going to be looking at some of the different parables that Jesus taught and just seeing what they have to say to us. And last week we looked at the parable of the hidden treasure and the parable of the pearl. And just kind of asked ourselves that question. And one of the points that we talked about was do I want more from God? Or do I want more of God? Both of these men, the man that found the treasure in the field and the merchant that was looking for pearls, right? They wanted more. They wanted more, and they were willing to sacrifice. They were willing to let go of everything in order to have more of God. Well, this morning we want to look at Matthew chapter 21, verses 28 through 32. And last week we talked about a couple of things that when we're looking at the parables, when we're studying the parables, a couple of questions that we have to ask ourselves in order to pull out the most that we can. And one of the things we have to do is we have to know the audience. So it's important that as you look at a parable, to go back a few verses and see who the audience was. Who was Jesus talking to when he shared this parable? Also, it's helpful sometimes to dig into some other extra biblical things, some other study helps, and find out what the culture of the day was. You know, what were the habits and the culture and the history of the day? And also, we have to remember that parables were not 3-point sermons or 10-point sermons. Basically, Jesus was driving home one particular point. Sometimes it might have been a little bit more than that, but basically there's one main point to the parables. And so those are some things that will help us. They're simple stories with a spiritual truth, and they will help us as we try to uncover what it is that Jesus is saying to us. What are these parables saying to us? Even though they were spoken thousands of years ago to a specific audience, God's word is living and active, and it speaks to us as well. So let's read Matthew chapter 21, verses 28 through 32. The parable of the two sons. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work today in the vineyard." "I will not," he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, "I will, sir," but did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." So we have to dig into this parable a little bit to find out and answer some of those questions that we talked about just a moment ago. Right, we have to look back at verse 23 of Matthew chapter 21 to figure out who is Jesus talking to. Who's the main audience that Jesus is sharing this parable with? And we see in verse 23, the main audience that Jesus is sharing this parable with is the religious leaders. Right? The chief priests, the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Yes, there were other people around because Jesus was in the temple and he was preaching, he was teaching. And so there was other people around, but the parable was spoken specifically to the religious leaders of that day. And again, it helps us to understand the context of this parable. You go back to the beginning of chapter 21, and at the beginning of chapter 21, what's over the heading in your Bible? The what? The triumphal entry, right? So chapter 21, Jesus, we're familiar with that story, right? It's a triumphal entry, right? Palm Sunday, Jesus has just entered Jerusalem, right, on the donkey, and they threw their coats and their palm branches before him, and they were praising him, and they were Hosanna, King of David, and all of that we're familiar with from Palm Sunday. So that's how chapter 21 begins. And you kind of real quickly peruse down through Matthew chapter 21, right? After that all happens, Matthew tells us in verse 12 that Jesus goes to the temple. And if the triumphal entry didn't get the Pharisees and religious leaders' attention, which it did, certainly what we see next did as well, right? Because Jesus goes into the temple and he sees them selling stuff and all of that, and he overturns the tables and he drives out the money changers, and he says to them, "Listen, you've made my house anything but a house of prayer, anything but a house of worship." Right, so now he's really got the Pharisees' attention. The triumphal entry, the overturning of the temple and calling out the Pharisees as well. Matthew chapter 21 tells us that from there he goes outside of the city back to Bethany. The next morning he comes in, and verse 23 tells us that he enters the temple courts. He enters the temple, and the religious leaders then, as he is teaching and preaching after all of this has taken place, Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, Jesus overturning and calling them out for making the temple a mockery, he's preaching, he's been healing some people, And the Pharisees come to him and ask him, which they've asked him several times throughout his ministry, by what authority are you doing this? What authority are you preaching? What authority are you teaching from? What authority are you healing people with? Obviously, Jesus knows it's a trap, right? And so he refuses to answer them, but he says this, if you will answer this question, I will answer your question. And he asked them about John the Baptist. Does John's preaching, does John's baptism, does John's teaching come from heaven, or does it come from men? And Jesus backs the Pharisees into a corner because he knows that the Pharisees know that if they answer, this is from men, the people will be angry because the people had high respect for John the Baptist. And if they say John the Baptist's ministry was from heaven, then they would ask them, hey, how come you as Pharisees aren't following? Why did you reject John the Baptist? So it's in that context, it's in this context that Jesus shares not only this parable, but this is the first of three parables that Jesus shares with the Pharisees that's talking specifically to the Pharisees. And if you jump towards the end of chapter 21, verses 45 and 46, this is after two of the parables. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parables, they knew he was talking about them. They looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. Then if you look over verse 15 of chapter 22, when the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him in his words, they sent the disciples to him along with Herodians. And so they were looking for ways to kill Jesus. And so this was the outcome of the parable. So the parable is pretty simple, really, that Jesus shares with them. This first one, the parable of two sons, right? A father is pretty wealthy. He has two sons. They have a vineyard, and he says to the first son, I need you to go work in the vineyard today. And the son says, not a chance, not going to do it. But later on in the day, somehow he changes his mind, and he does go and work in the vineyard. The second son is very polite, very courteous, says, yes, sir, I will go work in the vineyard. But what does he do? He doesn't. He doesn't go and work in the vineyard. And so Jesus asked them, who did the will of the Father? Who did what the Father wanted? The one that said no, but then did? Or the one that said, yes, I will, but doesn't? Again, the Pharisees aren't complete idiots, right? They understand, right? The one that did the will of the Father was the one that actually went and did the work. While he refused at first, he does go and do the work after changing his mind. So who do all these people represent? Well, the first son, as Jesus talks about, represents the tax collectors and the prostitutes, right? Represents the sinners, right? They reject God at first. They reject God's message. They rejected Jesus at first. But then later on, they choose to be obedient to him. The second son represents the religious leaders, right? They say yes. They say that they will do what God wants, but they don't really, right? The father in this parable represents God. And the vineyard represents the world, represents God's calling, what God wants us to do, being obedient to God out in the world. And so this parable is really a wake-up call for the Pharisees. It's a wake-up call for the religious leaders, right? They were in danger of missing out on the kingdom of God. The tax collectors, Jesus said, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the sinners are entering the kingdom ahead of you. Most versions say ahead of you. Some versions say instead of you. The sinners, the tax collectors, the Pharisees were entering the kingdom of God ahead of the Pharisees, ahead of the ones that look like they were headed to heaven. Jesus is optimistic here, saying ahead of, hoping and having hope that the Pharisees would turn around and become like the first son and actually go and do what the Father wanted. Right? Jesus is really hitting them upside the head with a 2x4. Right? He's pointing out to the religious leaders and the Pharisees and the teachers of the day, the religious people. Hey, he's pointing out that they're hypocrites, right? That they're hypocrites. And what is the definition, a simple definition of a hypocrite? Saying one thing and doing another, right? I mean, that's a simplistic definition of a hypocrite, of saying one thing and doing another. And that's exactly what they were doing, right? They were saying one thing, but yet doing another. We see in this parable that Jesus shares, right, the second son calls his father sir, right? Very respectful. And it's interesting, the Greek word that is defined or that is translated sir here is the same Greek word that if you flip back to Matthew chapter 7, part of the Sermon on the Mountain, in Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, wherein here Jesus says, hey, listen, not everybody that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, right? And that same Greek word that's translated sir in this parable is also translated Lord here, right? And so they're saying the right things. The Pharisees are saying the right things, but they aren't doing the will of the Father. They're saying that they're living righteous lives, but they aren't. They rejected the message of John the Baptist, which Luke tells us that the message of John the Baptist was repentance. Right? Repentance for the forgiveness of sins, of producing fruit in keeping with repentance. So, with all of this background, what is the point of the parable for us? What is it that we need to pull out of this parable for you and I living June 26th, 2022, in this time? What is it that we need to pull out of here for us? A couple of things, right? We as people, we do as human beings, we take something simple and make it complex, right? Jesus had one main point here. Well, I'm going to bring out three of them. One thing that we can pull out of here is we have to be careful to use the right measuring stick. We have to be careful that we're using the right measuring stick. What do I mean? What are you using as your measuring stick of your spirituality? What are you using as your measuring stick of spiritual maturity? What are you using as your measuring stick for spiritual growth or of righteousness? Right? The Pharisees were using external things. Right? They were measuring their spirituality. They were measuring their spiritual growth. They were measuring their spiritual maturity by external things. Right? They made sure that they looked good. They made sure that they looked good spiritually. Because when you read through the New Testament, what did the Pharisees did? What did the Pharisees do? They prayed. They went to church. They tithed. That's you and I, right? They were using those external things. They were using those external things as their measuring stick. But turn to me one chapter over. No, I guess it's two chapters over, 23. Matthew chapter 23, verses 27 and 28. Right, they were using those things as their measuring stick. Probably most of us here this morning have fulfilled those three things, right? You're here in church. You pray. And you put some money in the boxes out there. But look at what Jesus said of using that as your measuring stick in verses 27 and 28 of Matthew chapter 23. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you've neglected more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former. You blind guides, you strain out the gnat, but you swallow camel. Someplace else in Matthew, he says to the Pharisees, listen, you're just whitewashed tombs, right? Inside, you got dead man's bones. Right? When you use external things, that's not the measuring stick. We have to be careful the measuring stick we use. The Pharisees also were using the measuring stick of comparing themselves to others. Right, in Luke chapter 18, verse 11, when one of the Pharisees was standing in the temple, he said, man, I'm glad I'm not like this tax collector and these other evildoers that are here in the temple. Right, they were using that as their measuring stick of their spiritual growth, of their spiritual maturity, right? I'm a better Christian than they are because I don't. Right? I'm a better Christian than they are because I do. You can fill in the blank that was, be careful of using external things as our measuring stick. Right? Scripture tells us the measuring stick that we have to use as a measuring stick is our heart. It's our heart. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, God says, man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Right? We have to constantly, you have to, I have to constantly monitor my heart. You have to constantly monitor your heart. Is your heart, is my heart aligned with the heart of God? Is my heart longing for more of God? Is my heart devoted to God? Am I allowing the Holy Spirit to soften the hard areas of my heart? You have them. I have them. There's that warning that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 8, that we also read about in the Old Testament, where Jesus says, these people honor me with their lips, but what? Their heart is far from me. This week I was just flipping through 1 and 2 Kings and looking at the different kings of Israel and Judah. In multiple places in 1 and 2 Kings, it talks about such and such a king's heart was fully devoted to God, or such and such a king's heart was not devoted to God. And then as I was flipping through there and looking at those different passages, I ran across that verse in 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 4. Right? As Solomon grew old, his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not fully devoted to the Lord his God as the heart of David, his father, had been. And I got thinking about that verse. And if your name is not Solomon, take Solomon out of there and take out wives out of there. And what might be true for you that you might put in there? Are there things in your life that are turning your heart away from God to other things? We have to guard our heart. As blank grew old, politics turned his heart after other gods. As Solomon grew old, money turned his heart to other gods. As such and such grew old, anger turned his heart to other gods. Whatever the case may be, we have to constantly monitor our heart. We have to guard our heart so that people and situations and life and circumstances don't turn our heart away from God, away from being fully devoted to God. David prays that prayer in Psalms chapter 139. Search me and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts and ways. So this parable I see in here is reminding us that we have to make sure that we're using the right measuring stick. Right? As you think about your spiritual growth and your spiritual maturity and all of that, it's about the heart. It's about the heart. We have to constantly monitor the heart to make sure we're fully devoted to God. And that's a whole nother study. That's a whole nother sermon. What does that mean to be fully devoted to God? But if we're going to use a measuring stick, we have to make sure we're using the measuring stick of our heart. A second thing I see in this parable is it's not about sitting and soaking, but it's about serving. It's not about sitting and soaking, but it's about serving. Being a part of the kingdom of God is not about sitting around and enjoying the blessings of God. It's not just about coming to church or Sunday school or a Bible study or a prayer meeting and soaking up more spiritual knowledge and getting fat spiritually. Right? There's work to do. There's work to do. Right? There's work to do of applying the spiritual knowledge that you have learned and are learning. There's work to do of being the hands and the feet of Jesus. Right? There's work to do of showing the love of Jesus, of showing and sharing the love of Jesus with others, right? The Father asked his sons to go and to work in the vineyard. God continues. He's still calling people to work for him, to serve for him. And I'm not talking about just serving and working full-time as pastors or missionaries or something like that. That's part of it. But just because that's not what God has called you to do doesn't mean that you don't have to work, that you don't have to serve, that you don't have to be Jesus' hands and feet, that you don't have to share and show the love of Jesus. A few chapters before this, Matthew records Jesus saying, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." And nothing has changed since Jesus said those words. Too many Christians are content to sit and soak. Too many Christians are content to just sit and soak rather than serve. To apply and to put into practice what we know and what we've learned and what God has shown us and taught us. For you that are worshiping with us online, how are you serving? How are you pointing people to Jesus? How are you being a disciple that makes a disciple? And for those of us that are here in person, how are you serving? How are you pointing people to Jesus? How are you being a disciple that makes disciples? Right, we see that pattern in Scripture, the biblical pattern, right? Jesus called his disciples, invested in disciples, and then they in turn went out and made other disciples, invested in other people. And those people who became disciples turned around and invested in other people and helped them to become disciples. It's not about sitting and soaking, but it's about serving. Jesus has work for you to do. And when he's done, he'll call you home. But if you have a pulse, if you're breathing, make sure the person next to you is breathing, right? And you got a pulse. If you have a pulse, he has a purpose for you. He has work for you to do. Maybe it's not what you used to be able to do when you were 19 or 20 or 15 or 18 or 50 or 60. But God has a purpose for you. He has a work for you to do. It's not just to sit and to soak up God's blessings, as great as they are. But we are to do the work of the Father. There's a vineyard out there that needs tending to. There's a vineyard out there that needs harvesting. There's a vineyard out there that needs God's people to be his hands and his feet. God has work for you to do. And the good thing about it is that when God has work for you to do, he has given us the Holy Spirit that will equip us and empower us for that work. Peter, one of the disciples of Jesus, later on, as he was ministering and serving in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, he writes this to the people. "Each one of you should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms." Right? When you are serving, when you are being Jesus' hands and feet, you are administering, you are showing, you are sharing God's grace. And I don't care how long you've been a Christian, whatever your measuring stick you've been using, we all need God's grace, right? We all need God's grace. The people out there, they need God's grace. Whether you're a religious leader, whether you're a Christian, whether you're a tax collector, whether you're a prostitute, whether you're a sinner, whatever, right? We all need God's grace. And as we serve, as we go out in the vineyard and serve in the ways that God has called us to, we are administering and showing God's grace. Galatians 5:10, Paul says, "Serve one another in love." So make sure this parable is telling us to make sure we're using the right measuring stick. It's our heart. It's our heart. Right? It's not about sitting and soaking, but it's about serving. And then lastly, a third thing that I see in this parable for us today is about obedience. Right? Obedience is a sign of repentance. Obedience is a sign of belief. We all know, right? We all know that talk is cheap. Repentance, belief requires obedience. Right, the one son talked good. Right? He was very respectful to his father, calling his father sir, calling his father master. Yes, I will do it. But yet he doesn't. He never does it. Talk is cheap. Jesus says, if you love me, in John chapter 14, verse 15, if you love me, you will obey what I command. James, the brother of Jesus, the half-brother of Jesus, in James chapter 2, verse 17, says, faith, if it's not accompanied by action, faith, if it's not accompanied by obedience, is dead. And then we have Paul telling Titus in Titus chapter 1, verse 16, listen, there's some people out there that they claim to know God, but by their actions, they deny him. Then Paul has some pretty harsh words, right? They are detestable, disobedient, and unfit for doing anything good. Right? We can't pick and choose what we're going to obey. Right? We can't pick and choose what we're going to obey. That's what the Pharisees did. That's what they did. We read that passage earlier in Matthew chapter 23, right, where Jesus said, hey, listen, you tithe, right? You come to church. You're in the temple. You read Scripture. You read the Old Testament. Yeah, you obey those things, but you've neglected justice. You've neglected mercy. You've neglected faithfulness. You've neglected loving other people. But we can't pick and choose what we obey. Now, I'm not talking about legalism. I'm not talking about we have to go around with this checklist all the time and making sure we check off all of these things. Life becomes a bunch of rules. We have to check this off every day. No. But it's a relationship, and in that relationship comes obedience. Out of love for God and a grateful heart to God, we choose to obey God. And again, it goes that complete circle all the way back to the heart. It's the measuring stick is our heart. But obedience to God is a sign of true repentance and belief. And so we need to be like the first son, right? Maybe it took him a bit, but he served in the field. He obeyed the will of his father. His heart became aligned with his father's heart. And again, like I said, it boils down to our heart. This parable is all about the heart. The heart is our measuring stick. Our heart is the motivation. Out of our heart comes the motivation to serve, right? Out of our heart is the foundation of obedience. We have to continue to allow the Holy Spirit to keep our hearts soft. Man, in the culture that we live in today, it's easy for our hearts to get hard. Easy for our hearts to get hard towards other people. And when it begins to get hard towards other people and other circumstances, it's not long before our heart gets hard between us and God. And so we have to make sure that our heart stays soft. In Proverbs, we're reminded, guard above all else. Solomon says, guard your heart, for it's the wellspring of life. Monitor your heart. It's not about sitting and soaking, but it's about serving in obedience. Obedience, it's a sign of repentance. It's a sign of belief. It's what God is looking for in a relationship with him and his people. So, Father, we thank you for this parable. This one of three that you really used to shake up the Pharisees one last time, and we know where it got you. They became very angry, and they looked for a way to get rid of you and kill you. But Lord, I pray that even though you shared these parables, specifically this one with the Pharisees, with the religious leaders, Lord, you were speaking to us today. Most of us here would say that we are religious, that we believe in you. And Lord, I pray that the truth that you spoke to the Pharisees would penetrate our hearts and our minds. Lord, we wouldn't use external things. We wouldn't use comparison of others to identify and to mark our spiritual growth and our spiritual lives. But Lord, it would be about our heart. Lord, every day, every moment of every day, that our heart would be devoted to you, that our heart would beat for the things that your heart beats for, that our heart would break for the things that breaks your heart. Lord, that we would not say yes and then not be obedient, that we would say yes and then not serve. But as great as your blessings are, you've called us for more than just that, that you want us to be out working in your vineyard, in your field, in the world, of being your hands and your feet, of sharing the love of Jesus and showing the love of Jesus to others and ministering your grace. We want your grace for ourselves, but Lord, may we administer and let other people see that grace. And so, Lord, just continue to resonate this psalm, this Proverbs in our heart and our mind as we go through this week, thanking you for your grace, thanking you for your Holy Spirit that empowers us and equips us to serve you. In your name I pray, amen. Let's stand as the worship team comes and leads us in this closing song that again, just reminds us of our heart, where our heart is at, and being obedient to him, wherever it is that he calls us, wherever he calls us to do.
Without borders, let me walk upon.
just bow your heads for just a second. Maybe there's others that the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you about something. You just want someone to come and pray with you and want to come up as I'm just closing in prayer. Father, we thank you for your presence here this morning. We thank you that you are moving, you are speaking to hearts and lives. We just talked about the importance of obedience, not just coming and sitting and soaking, but being obedient to whatever it is. There's nothing magical. You're not any more powerful up here than you are back there in people's seats. Lord, as we leave this place, may we be obedient to what you are speaking to us today about, whatever that is. Whatever that is in our life, whatever it is at this moment that you are speaking to us, may we be obedient to that, knowing that you're going to equip us and empower us. Satan's going to tell us a lot of things when we leave this place. But Lord, you speak truth. May we just continue to monitor our heart. May you check our heart. Make it fully devoted to you. Again, we just praise you and we thank you for what you are doing and are going to continue to do in the hearts and lives of the people here and in this church. We love you and we praise you. We ask all these things in the power of Christ's name. Amen. We are dismissed.